Should we start now? I think it's like 3 o'clock. Okay. So I want to start with asking some of you guys. So who of you is a Drupal developer? So like everyone, or the ones with the laptops who don't care. okay, who of you have written a hook menu as you see here? So, yeah, okay, pretty much. That's good. That's really good. Who of you have written some object-oriented code, like in PHP or some other language? Doesn't matter. Okay, so everyone is prepared. Great. About myself, I'm Daniel Wehner. At day, I'm studying physics. At night, I'm doing Drupal. And yeah. I'm sorry?
Yay, physics.
Yay, cool. okay. So what will this talk be about? So it will be about routing or routing. Depends on your native language. So what is routing about? Here's an example of a router, which is a network router. And all what the router takes care of is that every computer gets the content he has, or some kind of computer has asked for. The same is with routing in HTTP. So someone asks for a page, for example. Let's take node/123 as example. Now we really want to get some content out to the user, for example, who uses a browser. And the routing system basically cares about mapping this request, which contains the path information, and maps that to some kind of code which generates the output the user wants to have. Let's have a look how Drupal 7 solved this problem to generate content on a certain path. Here you see all the different things which have been done by hook menu. So you see, for example, the title, which is pretty much used on everything. You see the page callback, which was responsible to generate the content. But you see way more other, a lot of more other things, like local actions, contextual links. You see maybe a little bit smaller here, things like theme callback, breadcrumbs, and everything. So to sum it up, hook menu did too much. It was too complicated to either understand it completely or to do some advanced things. And yeah, therefore Drupal 8 basically works different. I will come to that later. Here's an example of hook menu in D7. As you probably know, you have a path here, some title, some page callback, and let's have a look at this page callback. This page callback takes care about displaying /user. So it depends when you are logged in. You want to see the user profile page of the user. And if you are logged out, you want to have the login form. And this is just the code which took care about that in Drupal 7. I will compare that to the Drupal 8 code. And you will see a lot of similar things on there. So Drupal 8. When Drupal 8 started, there was an initiative called Whiskey. And the idea of the initiative was, for example, to connect mobile devices with Drupal. You can either go with using a browser directly in your mobile phone, but you also want to have apps. And these apps want to talk with Drupal. So one approach which is often used is to access some content and get the content as JSON back. But you also want to get the content as HTML or as XML, depends on your needs. And in order to achieve that, Drupal wanted to have a good representation of the request as an object. And all kind of people looked around. What are other frameworks what are other frameworks doing for that? We want to have things like the current path. We want to have the the get variables, the post variables, everything in an easy accessible way. So people looked around, they looked at the Scent framework, they looked at the Symfony framework, and luckily the founder of the Symfony framework came along and said in groups.org, hey, I can help you. And since then, Drupal relies more and more on the Symfony components. The Symfony component we are talking here is the router, which I will explain a bit more. But in general, don't panic. It's there has been a lot of blog posts and tweets and everything about, whoa, it's so horrible, it's complex, it's Symfony, I don't like Symfony, stuff like that. But keep cool. The world is changing, but yeah, keep cool. So let's have a look at a general overview how the routing works. So this is a, it tries to explain what goes on a page. So on the left side, a request comes in. As before, it's either a browser surfing on the page, or a mobile device, or some other server talking directly with Drupal. And the goal is to serve a response. On the right hand, you have the response. It's either HTML, JSON, and you have some additional metadata attached to that, like the status code. So if it's 200, which means everything is great, or it's 404, which means the page could not be found, or 403 if it's not accessible. Yeah. From Symfony, there's an object for that, which basically converts the request to the response. This is called HTTP kernel. This is a black box, it just works. And how, so it converts the request to a response, but how does it actually can create a response? All what it does is to use some piece of code, which is called the controller, and this controller generates the response for you. So now the question is, how do I know the controller, alias, how do I know the piece of code which has to be executed? And this is exactly what the routing system tries to do. It determines the controller for a given request. So there's either, there's for example, a route for slash user, and for this slash user route, you want to display some specific thing. So here you see the routing system. It's coming from Symfony directly, and Drupal 8 is using some routing components from the Symfony CMF project, from the guy who just went in. And yeah, I will not go into details how this works internally, just pretends it works. I will talk more about how to actually do something with it. So let's have a look again at the past. Here's the a piece of code which generates the content of the current page. It has some logic, like if the user is logged in, then go to a certain page. This is how it will look like in Drupal 8. You have everything now in objects and classes, or in classes, which have a certain namespace. Here you have, for example, the user controller in the namespace tuple slash user. In Drupal 8, we are using PSR0 as a schema to know where exactly the files are. So tuple slash user controller means the file is in tuple backslash, oh, it's, I don't know. Well, it's just the namespace directly matches to the folder names. Yeah, so here you have a controller, which is actually the method here, which is the user page method, and this method creates the content. So it takes, gets the user from the current user function, redirects or builds a form. Yeah, but how does Drupal actually, or how does the routing system actually knows what kind of controllers exist, and therefore we register this packages of information, so-called a route, in a routing.yaml file. So each module you have can create a, or you can create a module name.routing.yaml file, which consists of the machine name of the route. The machine name is a unique name. You can name it how you want, but the naming convention is like module name dot something. So this is a machine name, and it has some information, like the path this route should be attached to, and the controller which is used. This is in a key called defaults, and the controller which is used is most of the time underscore content. I will explain a bit more later. So how do you specify the method? So it's here's the class name, the full class name with a namespace. So tuple slash user slash controller is the namespace, and user controller is the class name. And then you do colon colon user page, and this means that the user page method on the user controller class is used. Yeah, just a as a comparison, in tuple 7, this was basically the page callback, this thing here. So if you have done that, and you would have used the right screen size, you would have seen the proper page here. And yeah, that's so far. But yeah, the routing YAML file is way more advanced, which means you can configure more and more stuff. So let's start with what I call controller types. Tuple has, we have seen the underscore content, which is basically, I want to display something on the page, which means I still want to render all the blocks on the left and the right side. I want to have the toolbar at the top. Yeah, maybe some footer on the bottom. Therefore, we use underscore content. This is some kind of tuple convention. Another really important thing is underscore form. Underscore form is about displaying a form on a page. Yeah, I will also cover how to deal with forms in tuple 8 later. Another one is underscore controller. This is actually the way how you do it in Symfony correctly, or how the standard implementation works. And an underscore controller should be used to generate raw data like JSON or something like that. There are additional helpers for dealing with entities. So for example, you can use underscore entity view and then the entity type here node to render a certain entity. Or you can use entity form to display a form for an entity. And this makes it really convenient to work with it, because if you would have to care about all the different logic which are involved with loading and with loading entities, creating a form for an entity, submitting and saving the entity and everything, it would be too complicated. That's why we have created these helpers. These helpers are not hard-coded in a sense, but you can theoretically extend the system that you can provide your own little helpers. A little bit more here in the routing YAML file. We are still looking at the path. So in most cases, or in many cases, you don't want to have a static path. You want to have some kind of arguments in the path. So for example, node slash 123, and you want to have node 123 as a parameter passed along to your code, which is executed. So you can have a path. Here's now a quite complex example. So we have four parameters. Parameters are expressed in curly brackets, and you see here JS, view, display underscore ID, and type. And these are passed along to the controller method directly. As you see, the order doesn't match. So it starts with Vue, and then JS comes, or JS actually there. So it doesn't matter the order. One important thing I want to mention here is the ability to convert IDs to full objects. This is called parameter conversion in Drupal, and the main parameter conversion is loading an entity from an existing entity ID. So here you see view. We have an entity type called view, and we basically, so the system loads the view for you. So in the UL, you for sure just have a machine name of the view, and in your actual code here, you have the full object with all the methods attached to it automatically. Yeah. Yeah? Ah, okay. Yeah, so it was percentage foo, and then foo load is called. So if you want to specify your own ones, you can do that. I have an example as an additional slide, which I can show you afterwards. But it's possible for sure. I'm not sure whether actual node loads still exists. It doesn't work anymore because hook menu is not there anymore in the classical sense. If you have not registered something through the routing YAMLs or the routing system, it won't be displayed on the page. So we had a concept of a. Yeah, you will be able to. Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. If you want to have that behavior, you can create some array called options, and then some kind of JSON structure, YAML structure to specify that you want to have a certain entity type. And so this this parameter name is that entity. Yeah, that's possible. But it's not required by default. It's relying on that kind of magic, which is maybe bad because it might cause some bugs. But I really like it because you don't have to deal with quite a lot of stuff. Any questions? Okay, good. So let's go back to the path. In many cases, you want to have optional parameters. So you have, here in this example, you have the delete form for user, and by default, Drupal passes some additional parameters along. If you want to default to value, you can default it here. So if you go to user slash a number slash cancel slash confirm, there will be still something displayed. If you don't specify a default value here, it will say 4-4, exactly. This is directly coming from Symfony. So sadly, there's more than just the content of a page or the content of the response, because there's, for example, the title. So people talked about, does the title belong to a route? And we decided yes, because it's the title of the page, or maybe the title of the breadcrumb. If you build a breadcrumb with a certain route, you want to have the title on there. And because of that, you can also specify the title here with underscore title in your routing YAML file. But people realized, oh, we actually need some parameters from the URL, for example. So in this example, we have user slash user, and we want to display the username as the title of the page. So we came up with the idea of title callback. And yeah, this is the same syntax as for controllers. So you have class name, colon, colon, function name. I'm not sure whether there's a better way to solve that. But it at least works. Then people realize we actually want to dynamically alter the title. So on top of that, there's a way to specify the title in your vendor array. So I'm quite, yeah? Okay, I'm quite sure that everyone here used a vendor array before. So your controllers can return a vendor array, which is then rendered as part of the page. So this vendor array, the root vendor array level can specify a title, which is totally dynamic, depending on whatever happened on your page. Yeah?
So is either of those, so which of these two methods is the preferred one? Like if I have a static one, mm-hmm. like the static user one, mm-hmm. I could still do it in the render array. Right?
Yeah. So
which one is preferred?
So it's basically the other way around. Then it's written down. So if title is specified, so it's if hash title is specified, hash title will win. If title callback is specified, title callback will win. And if just underscore title is specified, the one will be used.
But the grep from the only include the ones that are specified in the
route. Yeah, exactly.
Will not involve the controller for the title for the grep.
Yeah, which is kind of a problem, but the problem is if you build a breadcrumb, you don't want to execute or to get the content of the actual page, right? Because you have a, like an actual structure. Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, but yeah, you want to have it as fast as possible. Yeah. And this underscore title, as Gabor said, is used for the breadcrumb and also for tabs and actions, and I will come to that later. So more stuff. This routing YAML file is quite powerful. So one thing Drupal came up with, okay, we need to check access for a page. Does the user have a certain permission? Does the user have a certain role? Or should we just allow access all the time? And therefore, therefore Symfony provides a thing called requirements. By default, Symfony allows you to specify regular expressions for the parameters in your URL. So like user slash 123, and you want to ensure that it's really a numeric, it's really a number. But what Tupel now here adds some additional things with, for example, underscore permission, which checks, does the user have the administer user's permission? Yeah, for underscore role, which is also important, does the user have a certain role? There are also convenience helpers for entities again. So does the user have access to a certain to a certain entity type operation. So for example, node.edit would be an example. Does the user have access to edit the node? This uses the node, which is then specified as curly brackets node in the path. And the final one, underscore access, is to always return true. These ones are single ones, but you can also specify multiple of them. So you can connect them with AND or logic. So if you specify here in options, doesn't care, any, it means that if one of the access checkers returns to or allows you to access the page, you will gain access. Otherwise, if it's all, you need to have access to all of them. So for example, here's now and more powerful system than we had in Drupal 7. Yeah. Let's continue. So If you start to build your controllers, you will realize that you need some external dependencies. For example, you need to be able to translate a string. So you have some kind of output and it contains some arbitrary string. Or you want to load an entity manually and do something with it, render it, for example. In Drupal 7, you would have just used entity load or the T function directly. But in Drupal 8, with all this object-oriented code, we want to have them either as methods available on the object or dependency injected, which means there's just some object passed into the constructor of your controller. But in most cases, you don't have to deal with it. You just extend the controller base class, which have all these convenient methods for you, like the entity manager. The entity manager is an object which deals with all kind of entity-related stuff, like loading an entity, rendering an entity, deleting an entity. For example, the URL method will generate you a new, will generate you one URL if you give it a route name and some parameters. There's all kinds of stuff in there. Here, let's have a look at an example. This is an actual code out of Drupal 8. This is a node controller, so this takes care about displaying a single node. And it gets the node as a full object, which is the node interface here. It asks for the entity manager and asks for objects, which allows you to build or view a node, and then it basically gives you, it basically asks, okay, I want to view this certain node. And that's it. Let's sum it up. In order to register all your routes to Drupal, you create a .module.routing.yaml file. Most of the time, you want to use _content to create your, or to specify the code which is executed. Title is set via _title, and the access is checked in the requirements. Let's continue with forms. So Drupal 8 still uses the form API as we had in Drupal 7 and 6 and 5 and so on. But we now don't have callbacks or simple functions anymore, but we do have actual objects, which gives us some advantages. Here you see the most classical form on all frameworks, languages, or whatever. It's a login form. So in order to display a form on a certain page, you certainly need to register some kind of route to be able to display that form on a certain page. Therefore, you use this _form instead of _content as before. And in this case, you don't have to specify the method, because each form is one can be somehow represented as one class. Here, as example, you have _form with the user login form. So what does contain a form class? Form class contains the form ID, which is some kind of name. It contains the build form method, which allows you to build the form structure. In this case, it's the username and the user password. And so this basically is exactly what you used to be doing in your form callback. Then there's the submit method, which is executed once you press some button. And there's also a validate form method. Here you can do everything you want. Just wanted to show an example here. In many times, you want to redirect the user to another page. Thank you. In this example, the user So this login form, so you want to go to user/123, and you don't have to deal with paths anymore, but you can specify a route name and all the parameters which should appear in the path, and then some URL generating method is used to redirect the user. There are some helper methods or helper form classes for you. There's the form base, which is basically the same as controller base. There's config form base, which deals with configuration forms. There's confirm forms, which is about confirmation forms, like, do you really want to delete that node? And there's also an entity one. Let's continue with some more of the features of hook menu. So for example, you have the features of tabs, aka local tasks. In Drupal 7, you used to have an entry in hook menu for that. And now it's separated out into an additional YAML file. In this YAML file, you have, again, a set of local tasks here, which has have a machine name. Here you specify not the path anymore, but the route name. So this route name is then used to generate the URL. A task has a title, maybe some weight to set the proper order. And the most important thing is the tab root ID. So if you look at this example, you have login, request new password, create new account. So every time you are on one of these tasks, the other ones should appear as well. So you specify the same tab root ID, which is this machine name on the top, for all of the three ones. And it will be displayed. We have in Drupal, as you know, many kind of UI concepts. So this is another one, add content. This is a local action, which you see on the list of all content. So you can easily create some content. This is, again, another YAML file, which is local underscore actions. You again have a machine name, a route name, and a title. And the important information here is where should it appear on. And there you specify a list of routes where this is where the local action should appear on. And yeah, that's it for that. Another concept are contextual links. So you can, on your website, hover over some elements and some little list appears where you can say, OK, I want to configure that block, for example. How do you do that in Drupal 8 now? You specify them via contextual-links.yaml file. Again, machine name, title, a route name, and a group. So for example, everything which should appear on blocks is named or tagged with a block group. And then in the contextual links YAML file, you specify, hey, I want to use to display the group block. Another one are breadcrumbs. So the default implementation for breadcrumbs is really simple. You take the current path, and then you cut the last bit after the last slash, and you cut it up again and again. So you start with node/add/article, and you cut the article, then you cut the node, and each time you look whether there is a route for this exact path. And on this route, as we have learned before, there's a title, and we have the route name, so we can create a link with a title based upon that. This is the path-based breadcrumb, but there are other implementations in core. For example, we can have a breadcrumb based upon the taxonomy hierarchy of your content. Or you can do whatever you want in a contrib, which will happen for sure. What else does Drupal provide? There are also menu links. This is an ongoing discussion, so it will probably be hook default menu links or some other YAML file. Yeah, I will not show that. Finally, I will come to raw data. If you want to send some JSON in this example out, you have to, or you should specify underscore controller instead of underscore content as before. And there you return some JSON response object, which is an object which takes care about rendering something as JSON. But what you should actually should use is the REST module. The REST module will provide you automatic integration of all your entities, for example, into the routing system or also for other custom stuff like Watchdog. You can look this up this presentation from the TupelCon blog, I think, and it contains all the interesting information. Finally, I want to present you a little benchmark I did on the performance of the routing system. I did like 100 runs, and all I wanted to know is give me or figure out from a path the controller. So I don't actually access the content of the page. I just want to have the information, or I want to have the route object, and I give the path. And I did that for tuple 7 and for tuple 8. And if you look at that, you have an average of like 2 milliseconds in tuple 7 and 2.5, a little bit more, in tuple 8, which is like 30% slower, but this should not happen that often on your page. And we and maybe my benchmarking was just too stupid. It was really just hacked together in a short moment. And we at least know that we can maybe improve something. Yeah. Thank you. Any questions? Yeah, go ahead. So yeah, so at the moment you can specify underscore content for Ajax callbacks, but this won't be possible in the future. So there's an issue which, yeah, removes the capability to do that. So if you have Ajax, you do underscore controller. If you have content, you have to specify underscore content. It's not fixed now, but yeah. Okay. Yeah. It works a little bit different. Yeah, we use dynamic routes, and we basically ask the database. So we just have one route for all node article add, or for all node forms. So we just have one route, which is node slash add slash curly brackets node underscore type. So then we use a database query with some fancy magic, and we get back one route for a given path.
So the magic there is the node types are config entities, so they are loaded in this parameter conversion process as config entities. If it's the right thing, or if it's an existing content type, and if it's not an existing content type, then it will not work because they are not it's not a valid config entity. And that's how it's basically deciding whether it's a valid path or not.
And also we have cases when we have not exactly the same number of columns arguments.
Well, in this system you can at least make optional parameters. So if you don't specify them, they are ignored. Is that what you need? But yeah.
You know, you can pass the additional parameters to the callback, yes, as additional arguments.
Oh, I see what you mean. Ah, okay, so you have arbitrary amount of parameters. Ah, okay. So I'm not sure whether I have an example, but you can also get the full request object. And so, as you have seen before, let me look at an example. Ah, it's actually there, cool. So you can not only specify some parameters in your controller method signature, but you can also specify this request object. And this is something from Symfony, which contains all the dynamic parameters. You can directly from there pull everything you need. Maybe Drupal could just provide a helper or actually split up the multiple arguments and put it somewhere into the request object.
So that means that you could rewrite your original user login example with requirements that you had a condition on whether the user is logged in or not?
Yeah, it would be totally possible. Yeah. One classical example is to use underscore format, which takes care about, so for example, you can do underscore format JSON, and if the browser requested some JSON, for example, if you use some console application or some server application, it will choose based upon your request that, oh, I wanted to have JSON, okay, this is the one route you want, and otherwise, if it's HTML requested, I'll get that route.
You can also use a different controller.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But this is actually a problem that the route names have to be unique, because if you link something with the in your code, you might actually want to be the route always existent. Maybe there's some problem with that idea. Tobias.
Mm-hmm. Type into the view object. So I just wanted to ask if it happens to be like the view.
No, that's not the one. That one.
Exactly. So you type into the view object in your controller or in your form. So if it happens to be that the num or the integer that is passed is not actually a valid view ID.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it will be a 404, yeah. So if it's invalid, you will get a 404. Internally, there will be an exception, I think, and then catch somewhere in the kernel. If you don't have access, but the view is loadable, then it will be 403. Depends on your case.
Oh, it checks the access on the view as well?
Hopefully. Yeah, I'm quite sure. That there is underscore entity underscore access, which takes care about checking access. Yeah.
How do you add your route?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, okay. This is dynamic generation. I don't have an alter. I'm sorry. But you can register so-called services in a .services.yaml files, which are global objects. And yeah, you can do that. And there is a thing called wad subscriber base. And it you can extend two methods of it. There's wads and there's alter wads. And alter wads gives you a collection or yeah, it gives you a collection of routes and you can alter them before they are dumped into the database.
Okay, so you can change the access
format. Yeah, yeah, exactly. Or you could change the path.
Okay, you get an array of the YAML file basically.
Yeah, exactly. And maybe some advanced use cases also need to specify dynamic routes, like any kind of content translation, config translation, views and field UI, and yeah, it's a bit complicated to do it properly, but yeah, you can also have dynamic ones in there. Yeah?
Okay, it's a little bit out of scope, but do we still possible to use some requests?
Yes, totally. Yeah, it is possible. If you do a sub request, so you are in a underscore content controller, called like that, and you do a sub request, you will get just the content.
Oh. You cannot use the raw content.
It actually checks whether your return value is a response object. If it's a response object, it will just ignore everything and just return that response object.
Oh, okay.
Hopefully. Yeah, it should. Yeah?
You mentioned that it's possible then to run a query to dynamically determine what content is there. Is that done on the routing or is that done after the routing?
So can you please repeat the question? Ah, okay. So, do you talk about the upcasting?
Or is that done like, so if you have like a purely dynamic piece of content, if you don't have a, if you want to make sure that this content exists, obviously, you know, you define a route and then you have this dynamic database lookup that you were talking about.
Yeah, yeah. So I think it happens on the on a kernel event, but after the routing system.
Okay. So that means that if the route has matched, obviously, and then you find out that there is no matching route, then obviously it would not attempt to match with another.
Exactly.
Router,
because
yeah,
all this information, what to actually load, is stored on the route object in the database. So if you don't have the route object, you can't do anything. Yeah.
I like very much the way we represented internal paths with no leading slash. So why can't
this have changed? I just know that Symfony does it like that. And it maybe you can answer to that, why we need slash in routing YAML files, or yeah, starting. Well, at least Drupal does it all the time, and could it be that maybe Symfony? I know that Symfony 2 got some multi-domain features at some point. And maybe with that you can say it appears on all domains or something, I don't know.
Ah,
So I know there is one route for the front page, and this, well, it would look odd if the path would be empty, but now it's just a leading slash for the route of the front page of your site. Yeah, exactly. Curly brackets, not curly brackets, the other brackets, front. Yep, continue. Okay, so how that works is before the routing system even started, there's a system called path processing. And this path process, so it happens before the routing system. And for example, path alias is one example of a path processor. So a path alias, so the path alias class just looks up whether there is an alias in the database. And if there's an alias, it just replaces the active URL. And then it continues, the routing system comes into the game and loads the route, and everything happens afterwards. There are other use cases, for example, multilingual. So you have a prefix with the language lang code, and it will strap it, but set the active current language. Yeah. So at least, so let's go back to the local task thing. Or local actions, these are links on your page, but you don't want to care about the paths. So all what is specified here is the route name, and in order to then render this link, we or Symfony gets the route object, gets the path, and replaces the parameters if there are some of them. So this is done automatically. Or if you you should rather use URL generating instead of specifying the path everywhere.
Yeah, so people may be being converted to using routes more and more to reject people and generate URLs. It's not fully converted yet.
Yeah.
But like the form example, you had also used routes to redirect people in the form submission. And there's now the entity operations have been recently modified to use routes, and there's more and more things that now use routes.
That's we figured out that this may be a performance problem, because if you render, for example, a menu structure, then you have different kind of routes for each menu item, which means we have to load them somehow. And which could mean 50 database queries or 50 cache queries. And one idea is to lazy load them, or to lazy load just the one which appear on the front end. So every route which appears for the normal user will be loaded all the time, just an idea. And the ones with slash admin, it won't be loaded automatically. So it is fast for the normal user. No one else? Great, thank you.